Psalm 85, page 13. Let me hear God the Lord speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will be, righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will go down from the sky. The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him, and will make a path of his steps. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And from Ephesians 1, 3 through 14. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplished all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people, to the praise of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The word of the Lord.
Whatever you ask of me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, "What should I ask for?" And her mother replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." And immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." So the king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. So he went and beheaded him in prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. And when the disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. You may be seated. Well, there is a temptation for us this morning, like Herodias, maybe to dance around the gospel reading for this morning, the death of John the Baptizer, the beheading of John the Baptizer. And it wasn't just that John the Baptizer was beheaded, but we have this gross and grotesque image of his head that is served up on a platter. And so it's easy to dance around a text like this, for preachers at least, to pick another text. But I think John the Baptist's beheading is kind of a gut check for each and every one of us. A kind of a grotesque, yes. A kind of an unsettling image, of course. But one that teaches us that our faith, and certainly our life, is not that easy, it's not that simple. So this is a story for us that maybe it's difficult for us to wrap our minds around, but indeed it is an important story for us. And this is perhaps why the gospel writer puts the John the Baptist story, the beheading of John the Baptist story here, totally out of time and totally out of place. The disciples are riding high on the power of Jesus' healings and teachings and miracles, and it is in this state that Jesus sends his disciples out. And if you remember last week's gospel lesson, he tells them to do their work, bringing very limited resources with them, and to expect that they will be rejected, to expect that they will not be welcome in most homes. They are to expect that they will be rejected because of this message that they are bringing to the people. So just in case we don't get it yet, in case we think that this message is about our own power or our own glory, we are now told of John the Baptist's beheading. So we don't think that this whole following Jesus thing is about our power or our glory. This following Jesus thing is really about losing ourselves. It is about denying ourselves, giving up ourselves. It is indeed following Jesus, the cross that we bear in this life. And so this week we're faced with this stark contrast between Herod's glory and his wealth and his power and John's suffering, John's poverty, John's weakness, and the power that is manifested in that, and how he dies at the hands of the wielding of power for the purpose of destruction. And that kind of power is always gross and grotesque and unsettling. I was in the Twin Cities last week, and I happened to have an opportunity to have conversations with people that I didn't know, and so as I was introducing myself, we had a long ways to walk together or run together, and so as we visited along the way, we kind of shared about, you know, what we do for a living. So I shared that I was a pastor of a Lutheran congregation in a small town of Dawson. The friendly woman beside me, my new friend, we suffered together running a race. She asked, "Well, is your church growing?" And I thought to myself, well, it depends on what you mean by growing. I mean, there are different ways to interpret the word growing. I mean, there's kind of spiritual growth, I suppose. There's a growing in the faith. And she said, well, is your church full on Sundays? And I kind of looked up at the sky and, you know, hesitantly said, well, there's always room for more. They aren't exactly lined up around the block waiting to get into church. I would have to say that. And she looked at me and she was kind of shocked at my low self-esteem. Well, I told her, I said, there's really not a huge market for the message that Jesus bids you to come follow him and to come and die in the process. There isn't a huge market for that in the world today. People don't exactly line up around the block for that type of message that Jesus gives. But Jesus wants to make you rich seems to be doing really well right now, I told her. Jesus wants to give you all kinds of wealth, all kinds of prestige, all kinds of power. And it's easy enough to understand, I think, that attraction for us. I mean, on some level, we all want to be victorious. I think on some level, we all want to be successful. We all want to be wealthy. So if someone is willing to tell me that Jesus happens to also want that for me, well, then it's pretty easy to follow this Jesus, you know? Sign me up. I'll be part of that bandwagon in a hurry. So that's good news, right? That's good news because we all want to be victorious. We all want to be wealthy. We all want to have levels of prestige in our society. That's good news. Except that it isn't. It isn't good news. It's just tempting news. That's all it is. It tempts us into something that no one can ever truly deliver for us. And Jesus knew this. Jesus knew this. He knew how tempted people would be to hop on kind of that Superman, miracle worker, healer, rock star, power bandwagon. And this is why in Mark, Jesus keeps instructing people not to tell anyone about his healings or his miracles. Because there's no way to know about who this God is. There is no way to know about who this Jesus is based only on the power of miracles. We only see who Jesus and God is when we look at the cross. So we sing songs like Lift High the Cross. And that's why we do that, because that's who we see who Jesus is, and that's who we see who God is. The problem is that we'll always choose the power of miracles every time. So the text this week prompts us to think about power in new ways. They prompt us to think about our own power, perhaps in new ways. They prompt us to think about how we use the power that has been given to us. Because, well, you don't need me to remind you, you have a ton of power. You have been given a lot of power. Power in your words. Power in your work. Power in your family. Power in your relationships. You have been given a lot of power. You have been given power through your witness to the faith. You have been given power through your baptism. So let me encourage you to consider that the power you have is not rooted in yourself, but it is rooted in God's love. And you have a power that comes from a starting point that is rare in this world. Because the typical place of power that we see in this world, sometimes even in ourselves, is this exercise of power that is damaging, or demoralizing, or demeaning, or discriminating, or despairing. And this kind of power is always gross. This kind of power is always grotesque. This power always seems like someone's head is being placed on a platter. And this is the kind of power that is being called out by God. It has to be called out. Herod's power totally forgot about things like justice and mercy. So in Herod's power, right and wrong were gone and forgotten. And John would die because of this power that Herod used in his life. And the thing of it is, I wonder how many people die because of the power that we use that is destructive or discriminating or despairing or debilitating. I wonder how many people die, even little deaths, because of the things that we do, the things that I do, the things that we say, the things that I say, that just takes a little bit of life out of them. We can use our power to damage others. We can also use our power that is found in forgiveness. There is power in forgiveness. There is power in mercy. There is power in building up of relationships. There is power in grace. There is power in justice. And this is a power that comes from God, the starting point of our faith and our truth and our mercy, the starting point of grace and dignity in our own lives and in the lives of those for whom we love and the lives in which we've been placed in a community with. A place, a power of high regard and respect for one another. So if we could just see that, and maybe even if we could just live in that type of power, your power that has been given to you by virtue of your baptism and by virtue of God's grace in your life. If we could see that and live that, I kind of wonder how many people would be lining up outside the doors, waiting.